السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers, we continue our topics from علوم القرآن, the sciences of or disciplines of the Quran. We have mentioned we are depending mainly on a book written by the scholar Al-Imam Al-Suyuti, Al-Itqan fi Ulum Al-Qur'an. And
where do you want
from his name is from Egypt. Yeah, and I have to find out exactly, but most likely from Egypt. He died in the year 911. That means he was like 500 years ago. 500 years ago. Al-Itqan fi Ulum al-Qur'an. And he tackled over 80 subjects in that book. We touch upon many of them, or several of them. We will not be able to cover everything. Many of the topics require knowledge of the Arabic language. Especially when it comes to grammar and when it comes to the badi'a and bayan and so on, which is very difficult to interpret into English. We have few subjects left which might be of benefit to us. And today's subject is at-tafsir and the most popular authors. Tafsir means to explain, to show details. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam main mission was to explain the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Furqan used that word, وَلَا يَأْتُونَكَ بِمَثَلٍ إِلَّا جِئْنَاكَ بِالْحَقِّ وَأَحْسَنَ تَفْسِيرًا. To clarify. And in the definition, the Ulum al-Qur'an definition, that it is to explain the meaning of the ayat and the meaning of the words and put it in the context and make the Qur'an is understandable book. There's another word, ta'wil, which is many times used in exchange with tafsir, but other times it has been used like to explain things from a glimpse or from some signal from the ayah, like ta'wil al-ahadith, the dreams. It has been used, that word, in Surah Yusuf, about the explanation of the dream of the king. And Yusuf alayhi salam was known to explain the or interpret those dreams. Imam Matridi, and you know him, he's a great scholar, specialist mainly in the Aqidah, like Imam al-Ash'ari, had explained that tafsir is not ta'wil. Tafsir, it is decisive, it's clear cut, that this is what God wants us to understand from that verse or from the ayah, while a ta'wil has many meanings without being clear cut. So it carry with it the probability. The first one is decisive, meaning like when the Quran says, wa aqim as-salah, I mean, no question about it, to establish prayer, to go to prayer. But there is the ta'wil, might, the verse might have more than one meaning. The scholars has mentioned that for the tafsir, interpretation of the Quran, to be authentic, has to have some guidelines. And especially in the person who is doing the task, al-mufassir. And any time you come across some kind of tafsir, you have to try to apply these rules, because otherwise things will be chaotic and in the hands of non-professional. And you won't allow this to happen in any knowledge, any discipline, like medicine or law or pharmacy. You have rules and regulation for every one of them to give you an interpretation or give you any explanation or any advice. And if you assume to be a doctor and write prescriptions without a license, or you end up to go to jail. The same thing, a lawyer cannot practice law without the bar exam. And many times if he committed felony or something, they take away from the right. So it is not right, it's a privilege. Many aspects of our life, we need rules and regulation to be allowed to do, including driving car. Also, it's not your right, it's a privilege. If you make accidents and you are endangering yourself and others, they take the license away from you, so you cannot drive anymore. So the same thing applies in Tafsir al-Quran. It's not anyone open the book and he start giving an opinion. You cannot do that. So the scholars have said the condition which need to be present or available or in the person who is doing the tafsir, number one, صحه الاعتقاد. He had to have a faith, which is the faith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions, and the majority of the ummah of Islam. So he has to have a aqidah which is healthy. You cannot ask an atheist to come and explain to the Quran. التجرد عن الهوى. He does not have to be following some cults or some groups or with an agenda, and he make that agenda his God, then try to twist the Quran and the interpretation of Quran to fulfill the agenda. So this whim and hawa is a serious disease inflicted or affected this ummah over the 1400 years, and we have Ahl al-Hawa and al-Mulal and al-Nihal, all of them, they have people who have some agenda, political or other than that, and they try to bring the Quran to give support to their claim. And in interpretation of the Quran, you have to have comprehensive understanding for the whole book. It is not enough to open a book and choose an ayah and try to explain the ayah. The same thing with the hadith, because as we know that the Quran and Islam as a whole came to us, or this is by design from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on stages. So many of the ayahs and the ahadith might be, the work on it is stopped, or at least some other ayahs came to abrogate, or some other ahadith restricted, something was allowed, or so on. So you need to understand Islam as a whole, the Quran as a whole, and the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you start explaining the Quran from the Quran, because many of the ayahs which has been brought in very detailed way in some surahs, in other surahs might have come in very short details, and those incidents can explain each other. So you start tafsir al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an. Then you have to understand the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which explain the Qur'an. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's role was to explain the Qur'an. لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. So this is one of the major things. So you cannot explain the Qur'an, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said something about it. You have to go and understand what he had said. And of course, those who carried the sunnah to us are as-sahaba al-kiram. The sahaba opinion, the sahaba interpretation, especially if they mention that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, or if they stop at their level, it's very important to understand what they have said. And after the sahaba, we know the tabi'een, the generation who came after the sahaba. Then atba' al-tabi'een, the generation which came after, and this is the best of the ummah. خَيْرُ الْقُرُونِ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. And this is the cream of the crop. Then after that, you go to the great scholars who compiled the hadith, like Bukhari and Muslim and Tirmidhi and so on, and you go to the great imams like Abu Hanifa and Shafi'i and Abu Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Imam Malik, because they have made the efforts, which we don't need to reinvent the wheel, by collecting all the ayahs and all the hadith and put it in perspective and see which one is abrogated. So you cannot open a Quran and take an ayah and say this is what it means, like وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى. So that means we can't drink. You know, this ayah said don't come to the masjid when you are drunk. It cannot work that way. And the same thing with the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The sahaba used to drink till the second, third year of the hijrah. So they've been drinking for 16 years of Islam, which is 23 years, the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a prophet. So we cannot take a hadith that Ali ibn Abi Talib and Hamza, they were drinking together. Oh, that's great, you know, they've been drinking, you know. You cannot. You have to understand the perspective, the time of the revelation, and so on. And we know this is, we give always the example of drinking because it's very clear cut, the stages which came when the companions ask about drinking. The first answer was, it's something people are doing, and like gambling and all of this. There is some benefit, and there is some evil things come out of it, and the evil thing is more than the benefit. So give you this. So people started, disliking. Always anything you lose, you don't like, and you don't try to do it. Then came the issue of they have to pray five times with the Prophet. They cannot come to the masjid drunk. So that means they stop drinking at least during all the day. And لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى. Then after they got rid of the habit of drinking, and this has helped to wean them off, because this is chemical dependency. We know that alcohol is a chemical and can make you dependent on it. So when that the alcohol in their blood started going away and they did not miss it, then came the prohibition that فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ, and they said انتهينا. So it was stages. Okay, so the great scholars, those four imams and other imams who reached the level of ijtihad, we mentioned when we studied those great imams, Imam al-Awza'i and Sufyan al-Thawri and Ibn Uyayna and Ibn Hazm, and all the way to Imam Shawkani, which we will talk about it shortly. All of those reached the level of ijtihad, and they can, you know, give their opinion. Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim, Jawziya, and all of those. And the condition of the, to know the Arabic language. You cannot interpret the Quran in English, you know, because really we don't have to talk about it. It's become very silly, you know. It's very obvious you need to understand the Quran in its Arabic language, because it is Quran and Arabiya. So it is, this is the way you have to understand it, not in the translations. And of course, the understanding of the Arabic language require from you the understand the history and the grammar, and understand also the other ulum which is related to Quran and so on, like ilm al-tawheed and al-usul and qira'at and so on. And of course, it's obvious, anyone who takes this endeavor has to be very smart and very encyclopedist and very serious scholar. It's unfortunately we are plagued or plagued nowadays with people who go to and they go to their own studies in chemistry or architect or agriculture, and then all of a sudden he become interested in Islam and Quran, and he started giving his opinions, and those are mainly from the Arabic countries, you know, and you find Mr. So-and-so is trying to tell you his opinion about the Quran. Some of them wrote books and so on. This is not their job. This is they should leave it to the specialist. So let's study the stages where the Quran was interpreted. As we have said, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the first interpreter of the Quran. It is one of his job description. We have mentioned many times. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ هو الذي أنزل سورة النبي الأمي هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. Kitab is the Quran and Hikmah is the Sunnah. So one of the job description of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to teach the Quran. And we know from Surah An-Nahl, ayah 44, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the first teacher of explaining the Quran. وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Then comes the role of us to comprehend and to ponder upon those ayat and to explain. As we have said, the Sahaba al-Kiram carried this after the, during the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and after that, and they understand all the aspects of the Quran and how to interpret the Quran. Of the Sahaba al-Kiram, we know specialty has started showing. We know some of the Sahaba good in the Ahadith, others good in the Quran, and others good in the Fiqh, and so on. So out of the Sahaba who are, they're very popular that they dealt with Tafsir al-Quran, is the four Khulafa, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, and Umar ibn al-Khattab, Uthman ibn Affan, and Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiyallahu anhum, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Ubay ibn Ka'b, and Zayd ibn Thabit, and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, and Abdullah ibn al-Zubayr. Those are very much dealt with the tafsir al-Quran to a large extent. Then comes lesser Sahaba, or who did not deal with the tafsir al-Quran as much, like Imam, like Sahabi Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, Anas ibn Malik, the servant of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Abdullah ibn Umar, and Jabir ibn Abdullah, and Aisha Umm al-Mu'mineen. They interpreted some of the Quran, but they were not like the first ones we mentioned. And as far as the writing, jotting down, writing down, those has not been done, okay? And we have emphasized on the issue, this is not something negative that they did not write down what they have said, because it is the society at that time, it is an oral society. Everything been transmitted by the oral tradition. And they have the qualification, the qualities of that. Even the Quran, as we have said, It is a book which has been revealed to be kept in the chests, in the hearts. The second stage of the Tabi'in and Tabi'at Tabi'in, we know also they were the students of the Sahaba, and they, many of them also had specialized in Tafsir al-Quran. And we see in Mecca, where Ibn Abbas used to teach, we have several of his students, like Sa'id ibn Jubayr. He was a great scholar, Tabi'i, and Mujahid, and Ikrimah, Mawla ibn Abbas, and Tawus ibn Kaysan, and Ata ibn Abi Rabah. We have studied all those great figures. So this is in Mecca, the school of Ibn Abbas. It's very versed in Tafsir al-Quran, and they were the leaders in Tafsir al-Quran in Mecca. While in Medina, where Ubay ibn Ka'ab has taught, many of his students excelled, like Zayd ibn Aslam, and Muhammad ibn Ka'ab, and Abu al-Aliya, and many others who studied in al-Medina. In the Iraq, in al-Kufa, where Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu, and Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, they were there, many of the students came down from them, like Alqama ibn Qais, and Masruq, and Aswad ibn Yazid, and Amir al-Sha'bi, and al-Hasan al-Basri, and al-Hasan al-Basri was in the Basra, but he is one of those in Iraq, and Qutada ibn Du'am al-Sadusi. All of those were scholars well known that they have contributed to the transmission of the tafsir of the Quran from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba al-Kiram down to the Tabi'in and Tabi'at Tabi'in. And this is was, as we know, at the time of Bani Umayyah. Bani Umayyah, and that ended with the end of that, and Bani Abbas came. At that time, the Tadween started at a large scale. And we went through this when we talked about the Ahadith and about the Fiqh. So the Tafsir started at that time. And most of those who wrote down or were very well known in Tafsir al-Quran from Tabi'in and Tabi'at Tabi'in, Yazid ibn Harun, who died in the year 117, Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj, who died in the year 160, and Waqi' ibn Jarrah, we have his name mentioned because of a line of poetry, Shakaytu ila Waqi'in su'a hifzi. So Shafi'i, that was the teacher of Shafi'i, died in the year 179. And Sufyan ibn Uyayna died in the year 198. And Rawh ibn Ubadah al-Basri died in the year 205. And Abdul Razzaq ibn Hammam died in the year 211. And many others. And what they have wrote down came to us through more major books. They have said that Waqi'a said so and so, and Yazid has said and so and so. Then came the age of the encyclopedists, those who correspond with the age of Imam Bukhari and Muslim, and those who accumulated large body of knowledge, and they wrote him down in major books or publications. Of them is Ibn Majah, the scholar, and Imam al-Naysaburi, and Ibn Abi Hatim, and Ibn Hibban, and Al-Hakim. All of those names, we have heard them from the Hadith of, and the books of the Hadith. But the name which all of us we should remember in Tafsir al-Quran at that stage is Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, this is one of the landmarks. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari died in the year 310. And we have mentioned that when he died, his family could not take him to the cemetery. They buried him inside his own house. It's a long story. So Ibn Jarir al-Tabari made a great monumental work, we will talk about it, which carry the opinions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through the Hadith and the Sahaba and the Tabi'in, Tabi'in, all the way to the Imams and so on. And it is a monumental book which others has depended on it later on. During the age of maturity of knowledge and the presence of centers of learning all over the Muslim world, there became some more specialization. And we know the people who are interested in the grammar, because the grammar is not above the Quran. The Quran is above the grammar. So you cannot tell me why the Quran said, put the word in like a fa'il, not a maf'ul, like a subject, not a... You cannot ask me, because the Quran who dictate the grammar. It's not the grammar who dictate the Quran. So many of the tafasir emphasized on the grammar and the language itself. And those are the nahawiyin or an-nuhat, like Imam al-Zajjaj and al-Wahidi and Ibn Hibban, Ibn Hibban and so on. While those who were interested in philosophy and interested in the abstract and the wisdom and so on, they made publication or tafsir of the Quran, which is colored or flavored by their mental specialty or their philosophy specialty and so on, like Al-Fakhr al-Razi, Others who are fuqaha, and when they interpreted the Quran, tafsir Quran, they emphasized on ayat al-ahkam and what they deduce from it and so on, like Imam Jassas and Al-Qurtubi. And those who were interested in the history, they have used the Quran and their interpretation to emphasize some of the stories and so on, like many of the scholars. Of course, in issues to targhib and tarheeb also, the ta'wil and so on been used by groups like Sufi and so on to, and they had some tafsir of the Quran with the emphasis on that aspect. Many other tafsir Quran emphasize on the words and the meanings or the history or the incidents and so on. So you find many, many publications, which is probably, the Quran itself is the main subject, but what they tackle of issues dependent on their own specialty. So based on this, we can divide the tafsir, which is available of the Quran al-Karim, into three categories. The first, at-tafsir bil-ma'thur, and this is the main body of tafsir al-Quran, which all of us, we understand what the tafsir is. To understand what the ayat meaning, based on the Arabic language and the incidents, the background, and so on, and what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the ahadith, sahaba, and so on. So this is a tafsir al-ma'thur. The most important book you need to know about it, the most popular one, is Jami' al-Bayan fi Tafsir al-Qur'an. This is written by Imam Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari. So Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, his book, which all of us we should remember, is Jami' al-Bayan fi Tafsir al-Qur'an. As we have said in it, you find what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the ahadith said, what the sahaba has said, what the tabi'een has said, and the scholars, and so on. And Imam Nawawi, who came 500 years after Imam Ibn Jarir, said that the book of Ibn Jarir is very unique. Nobody else classified a book like it. And Imam Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini from Egypt, he's Shafi'i, he said, if anyone make a journey to China to read the book of Ibn Jarir, it would won't be a waste of time and efforts. And this book is available, and it's in 30 volumes. The second book in the popular books in Tafsir al-Ma'thur, the tafsir which is based on the ahadith and based on the sahaba and the tabi'in and so on, is Bahr al-Ulum. Bahr al-Ulum, written by Imam As-Samarqandi, al-Samarqandi. He is faqih Hanafi, and he died in the year 375. And also the same way of Imam Tabari, based on Sahaba and Tabi'in and so on. And it is written in three big volumes, but it is still till now present in the libraries, especially in Egypt and in the Azhar, in the public library, and in the Azhar library, available in manuscripts. So it has not been published or printed yet. Bahr al-Ulum, Imam Samarqandi. So apparently the specialist would be exposed to it. They go there, they allow you to go and read it. The third book in At-Tafsir al-Ma'thur, Al-Kashif wal-Bayan an Tafsir al-Qur'an, lil-Imam al-Naysaburi. He died in the year 427. And in this book, the flavor of it is more grammar and language-related issues. And some of the negative point, he mentioned a lot of stories from other religions and from the Bible and so on, which we call it Israeliyat. And it is discouraged to depend on any other religious books to explain the Quran. The fourth book is Ma'alim al-Tanzil, written by Imam al-Baghawi. He is Faqih Shafi'i, died in the year 510. And it followed the same methodology of Imam Ibn Jarir and Samarqandi and Naysaburi. Then comes very important book written in Andalus, Al-Muharrar Al-Wajiz fi Tafsir Al-Kitab Al-Aziz. The author is Ibn Atiyah Al-Andalusi. He died in the year 546. And he is very strict on choosing the evidence from the Hadith and the Sahaba and the Tabi'in. And he depends a lot on the Arabic to understand the meaning of words by citing their origin in the Arabic poetry and also the grammar and language. And this book also still in a manuscript in 10 volumes available in Dar al-Kutub al-Masriya, the public library of Egypt. And they don't have the 10 books. They have only the third, the fifth, the eighth, and the 10th volume. The other, maybe, they are missing. But, you know, usually you might find them in some European libraries or in Turkish Istanbul library. The sixth book is in Tafsir al-Ma'thur, and this is the second monument. Ibn Jarir the first, this is the second, is Tafsir al-Qur'an al-Azim li-Ibn Kathir. Ibn Kathir. Abu al-Fida Ismail ibn Kathir, and this is not Ibn Kathir, the one we mentioned from ulama Mecca in recitation of the Quran. Ibn Kathir was like Tabi'i, but this is after 600 years from the first one. And this book, Ibn Kathir Dimashqi, he died in the year 774. And he had many other encyclopedic publications like Al-Bidayah and Al-Nihaya, which is a history. And he had many other books in the Hadith and others. In his book, he is very objective and very scientific. He would use the way of weighing the evidence and give his opinion, which he thinks right. And some other narrations, he tells you it is weak and so on. Also, he would avoid the stories coming from other religions and so on and show their invalidity. Right, yeah. I have read that many times when I, you know, how Ibn Taymiyyah was very influential, and he had like 7-8 brilliant students. I don't know if all of them studied under him or been from the same school. They might have met the student of Ibn Qayyim, for example. But Zahabi, Ibn Kathir, and Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyya, those few names of people who are students of Ibn Taymiyyah. The seventh book is Al-Jawahir al-Hisan fi Tafsir al-Qur'an, Imam al-Tha'alibi. It is a book which is based on Tafsir Ibn Atiyyah, and it has been printed in four volumes. The eighth book in Al-Tafsir al-Ma'thur is written by our scholar Imam al-Suyuti, and its name Ad-Durr al-Manthur fi Tafsir al-Ma'thur. Imam al-Suyuti, who died in the year 9/11, he summarized this book from an older book written by him called Tarjuman al-Quran. So apparently he abridged his own book, and it is based on the Musnad Ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is another manuscript, Tafsir Baqi ibn Mukhlid. Also, it's apparently been missed and it's not available. And the 10th book in Tafsir al-Ma'thur, which is also well known, is Fathul Qadir. Fathul Qadir, written by Imam Shawkani. Imam Shawkani died in the year 1250, which means he died only less than 200 years ago. So this is the closest to us, our generation. Imam Abdullah al-Shawkani, he reached the level of ijtihad. And he was born in Sana'a in Yemen. And he was raised on as a muttabi' on the Imam Zayd, Mazhab al-Imam Zayd. You know Imam Zayd or Zaydiyah, it is the closest of the madhahib to Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. And their difference based only on political issue and the who should be the first. But it doesn't go all the way to the deen and other major issues of aqidah and so on and so on. And he, anyway, grew out of his own inherited madhab and to become Imam Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. He's an imam for every Muslim, Imam Shawkani. And he had great books he left us, like Fath al-Qadir in the Tafsir and Al-Awtar of the Ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Irshad al-Fuhul fi al-Usul. And they are available in English and Arabic also. Ibn al-Shawkani has based his tafsir, Fath al-Qadir, on other previous books like Ibn Atiyyah and Imam al-Qurtubi and al-Zamakhshari. And he was very versed in the Arabic language, and he also based his knowledge on al-Mubarrad and Abu Ubaid and al-Farra, al-Mubarrid and Abu Ubaidah and al-Farra, and so on, of the great scholars in the Arabic language. So this is Kitab, the book of Fath al-Qadir, Imam al-Shawkani. Now we go to the second class of tafsir, which is the flavor of it, has, in addition to what we have mentioned, they go a little bit more to put some ijtihad. And this is called a tafsir bil-ra'i. And shouldn't be meaning ra'i that on their own whim, okay, or they sit down and tell you this is, no, this is third group, we'll talk about it. But here what it means, there is some ijtihad in their interpretation. And the most important thing, books in this group, the first is Mafatih al-Ghayb, lil-Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi. Mafatih al-Ghayb, Imam al-Razi, who died in the year 606. It is in eight volumes, and there is doubt that he finished it all. Imam al-Dhahabi, who is at the time of Ibn Kathir and so on, he tells us that he finished the book till Surah Al-Anbiya, then his student finished the book to the end. And Imam al-Razi, in his book, he bring issues of mathematics and nature and astronomy and philosophy to, you know, talk about many issues. But of course, his stand is in accordance with Aqidat Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. And he always also tried to rebut the Mu'tazila, the school of thought, which is based on, and they believe in the mind and the brain to be a god, and everything has to be filtered through the god, of course. And this is against our Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, which we believe the brain has its own role, but it's not in deciding what's plausible or not plausible, or what's can happen or cannot happen. And also he emphasized issues related to grammar and language. The second book in At-Tafsir Bil-Ra'i, Anwar Al-Tanzil Wa Asrar Al-Ta'wil, written by Imam Al-Baydawi. He died in the year 685. It has a flavor with emphasis to on the language and the grammar and the fundamentals of the Sunnah and the fiqh and so on. Also, he has a lot borrowed from Al-Kashaf, which is written by Imam Zamakhshari, and we will come to it later. Also, he borrowed from Al-Raghib Al-Asfahani in his book Mufradat Al-Quran. This book is important for the scholars and considered one of the textbooks, Anwar al-Tanzil wa Asrar.
Asfahani, this is language, right?
Asfahani? No, I think he's a scholar.
The flavor of his tafsir is?
It has in it a lot of deep meanings in of some of the ayat and so on. Zamakhshari is the one which is emphasized. He's from Mu'tazila, and he emphasized on the language also. So this is Anwar al-Tanzil wa Asrar al-Ta'wil. The third book is Madarik al-Tanzil wa Haqa'iq al-Ta'wil. I mean, they are using the same words, you know, all of this, so they will be mixed up together. And this is Imam al-Nasafi. He died in the year 701. And also he based his book on the Baydawi and the Zamakhshari and other books from who preceded him. The fourth book of At-Tafsir Bil-Ta'wil, Libab Al-Ta'wil Fi Ma'ani At-Tanzil, written by Imam known by Al-Khazin. The disadvantage of this book that he has a lot of stories borrowed from other, and it happened I had a copy when I was a child of this Al-Khazin, and I went through it, and there nice stories, you know, from Israeliyat and so on, Al-Khazin. Then comes a monumental work which is called Al-Bahr Al-Muhit. This is the ocean. Al-Bahr al-Muhit means the ocean, sea, which is written by Abi Hayyan al-Gharnati al-Andalusi. He died in the year 745 in Egypt. And it is available in 8 volumes. And it is, the flavor of it is language and grammar. And he borrowed a lot from Zamakhshari and Ibn Atiyah, also from his teacher, Imam Ibn al-Naqib. This Ibn al-Naqib, he had written a book or tafsir called Kitab al-Tahrir wa-Tahbir li-Aqwali A'immat al-Tafsir, encyclopedic collection of all the previous mufassirin, which is written in 100 volumes. Ibn al-Naqib, who is the teacher of Ibn Hayyan al-Gharnati, and he borrowed from him in Al-Bahr al-Muhit. Then comes the book of Gharaib al-Quran wa Raghaib al-Furqan, Imam al-Naysaburi, who died in the year 728. And it is a bridging of Tafsir al-Kabir al-Razi, and also he incorporated many ideas from al-Kashaf al-Zamakhshari, and has in it ilm al-Qira'at and many of the philosophical ideas and so on. Then comes a very popular book in the Tafsir, which is very available, and most likely people have exposed themselves to it more than any other book. Like Imam Nawawi, when he has the Riyad al-Salihin, it's the most popular hadith book, you know, more than Bukhari and Muslim, and so on, because it's for the public and for everyone. This one is Tafsir al-Jalalain. Tafsir al-Jalalain, written by a teacher and student. The teacher is Jalal al-Mahalli al-Shafi'i. He died in the year 864. His student is Imam Jalal al-Din al-Suyuti, our friend whom we are studying his book, who died in the year 911. It has been said that Imam al-Mahalli, Jalal al-Din al-Mahalli, has finished almost half of it, and Imam al-Suyuti finished the other half. And most of the Quran you see here in the libraries or book, and you have some explanation on the margin, this is the Tafsir al-Jalalain. You find it on the borders or boundaries of the book. Then comes the book of Siraj al-Munir, Imam al-Khatib, who died in the year 977, so this is after Suyuti. And closer to our time, there is Ruh al-Ma'ani fi Tafsir al-Qur'an al-Azim wa Sab' al-Mathani. The author is a scholar from Iraq. His name, Mahmoud al-Alusi al-Baghdadi. He died in the year 1270 of the Hijrah, which makes it probably 150 years ago. Ruh al-Ma'ani is a very important book, and he had studied all the previous tafsir, and according to this book that he borrowed from Ibn Atiyah and Ibn Hayyan and Zamakhshari and Al-Baydawi and Al-Razi, and summarized most of the ideas and put them in this book, Ruh al-Ma'ani. As far as the Tafasir al-Furaq, the people who have agendas and try to twist the Quran and to and skew the rays of the Quran based on their gravitational force, and many books, they are not that important nowadays in our life, like Tafasir al-Mu'tazila. Mu'tazila, as you know, it's people who were the time of Al-Ma'mun and a few other Khalifa after him, and they glorify the mind, and they put the brain in, or the mind in, a situation which has no business in it, you know, like issues related to Al-Ghayb. This is something the brain has nothing. I mean, the computer, of your computer, can it talk about heaven or it cannot, you know. It is the mind or the brain is created to solve our problem here. You have information from your sensories, then you process it in the brain, then you take action. That's the whole role of the brain. So Al-Mu'tazila, they had something good, you know, Kim, because they really stood up for the other religions and philosophers and so on from the Greek, and then they rebut their claims and so on. So they, we should mention the good and bad, you know. But it's unfortunate that we know the mihna of Ahmed ibn Hanbal and so on because of them. The important book is Al-Kashaf. Al-Kashaf عن حقائق التنزيل وعيون الأقاويل في وجوه التأويل, written by Imam al-Zamakhshari, who died in the year 538. And it is monumental work in the language and literature and grammar and ancestry and pedigree of the Arab tribes and so on. And it is very long book, and it is very interesting. And people till now, specialists, they go to it and read about benefit from it. As far as other firaq, there is every sect of Islam, they have their own book of interpretation, tafsir. We will skip that. And then we come now to the mystics, which we call them in Arabic, the Sufi or something. They have their own tafsir. The first one of them, written by Imam, by a person called Imam Tasatturi, who died in 273. But it is cover only few ayat, which he has seen some glimpses related to spirituality and so on. And then Ruh al-Ma'ani lil-Ulusi has in it some of these flavors. And there is a book attributed to Imam Ibn Arabi. Very controversial figure. Till now, I didn't find a book which talk about him objectively. Some of them make him all the way to be a heretic. Others make him a scholar and a mujtahid and so on. At any rate, that book, which is about tafsir, called Tafsir Ibn Arabi, the scholars, they doubt he has written that book. Okay, and it is available in two volumes. Now we go to the scholars who are specialists in fiqh, jurisprudence. So the Tafsir al-Quran al-Kareem, with emphasis on fiqh, the first one, important one, is Ahkam al-Quran, Imam al-Jassas. He died in the year 370. He is on the school of thought of Imam Abu Hanifa, and it is one of the most important book in Tafsir al-Fiqhi, which is emphasized on the Ayat al-Ahkam and so on. The second book, which is comes after that, is Ahkam al-Quran, carry the same name, written by Imam al-Harrasi in the year 500. He died in the year 504. He is a faqih Shafi'i, and he explained or interpreted Ayat al-Ahkam. And it is in one big volume. The third one, which happened to have copy of it, is Al-Jami' li-Ahkam al-Qur'an, lil-Imam al-Qurtubi, who died in the year 671. It is great book. I have it in 30 volumes, but every volume almost one juz of the Qur'an, with the emphasis on Ayat al-Ahkam, where he tell us about the adilla which has been deduced from those ayat, and also the knowledge of al-nasikh and al-mansukh, and also issues related to grammar and the qira'at. He based his book of on the Tabari and Ibn Atiyah and the other books before him, including Al-Jassas. And in his book, he would, during the, tells you about his encyclopedic knowledge, he would rebut the Mu'tazila and Qadariya and the Rawafid and the philosophers in their opinions. I enjoy reading in Imam Qurtubi, Ahkam al-Quran. It's a very fascinating book. Very easy to read, and that's what's beautiful about it. It's like written in our time. There is a few books which is called contemporary interpretation of the Quran. The most important one is Al-Jawahir fi Tafsir al-Quran, written by Sheikh Tantawi al-Jawhari. He died in the year 1358. That means in the year 1940. So that's in our life. Imam Tantawi Jawhari was a teacher in Egypt. And at that time, you remember, you know, the first exposure of the East and the West and fascination with the enlightenment of Europe and the advancement in technology and physics, chemistry, and so on. So many of the new ideas about the universe, he would incorporate or try to interpret some of the ayat. And this trend continued till nowadays. And we have every year a big gathering somewhere, Istanbul or other cities, about al-ijaz fi ulum al-Qur'an, because they went, you know, to deep extent talking about the what we can learn in the scientific field from the Qur'an. Then come Tafsir al-Manar. Tafsir al-Manar, written by Muhammad Rashid Rida, who died in the year 1354, also in our lifetime. He was from Tripoli of Lebanon, Tarablus, Sham. And his teacher was Muhammad Abdo. And he convinced Muhammad Abdo to interpret the Quran, and he would write down, like Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim, Jawziyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah, as far as I know, he wasn't that proliferative writer. And his students were used to write his fatawa and so on. So here, Muhammad Rashid Rida wrote down what Muhammad Abdu has interpreted the Quran in the masjid, and till the Surah of Yusuf. And they used to publish this every week or in a magazine called Al-Manar. But it stopped there at Surah Yusuf. I don't know if somebody else finished. According to this book, they stopped in رَبِّ قَدْ آتَيْتَنِي مِنَ الْمُلْكِ وَعَلَّمْتَنِي مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَنْتَ وَلِيِّي فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ تَوَفَّنِي مُسْلِمًا وَأَلْحِقْنِي بِالصَّالِحِينَ. Then Muhammad Abdu died at this ayah. ثُمَّ عَجَلَهُ الْمَلَكُ. And this is Tafsir al-Manar. They call it in the name of the magazine which published that book. Then finally, of the contemporary, it is not truly a tafsir, but it is living in the shade of the Quran, and called it's in the shade of the Quran, written by Sayyid Qutb, who was an intellectual, and who died in the year 1966. So, inshallah, next week we talk about next week is Eid, session we meet about I'jaz al-Qur'an. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.